on the Standard this morning. And of course, we're struggling to find political headlines. That's just one of them, but you can see how much heat it's generating. Rate cap to go up after Uhuru yields to IMF. The story is on page 4 of the Standard. Cheap bank loans set to end soon. You may soon receive a notice indicating that the cost of servicing your loan has gone up in case you borrowed money from a commercial bank. Now, this is because the IMF wants the president to either repeal or replace the law that controls interest rates. Now, this matter came in about 2 years back. Parliament passed this motion. The president signed it into law. 2 years later, there is a very high possibility that this could be reversed, and by September, we could go back to a liberalized banking market in terms of interest rates for loans. Now, coming from Mombasa as members of parliament, you must have had this discussion to some level, because yes, it will still have to pass through the house. It will come through the house. Mm-hmm. You're the same parliament, at least when Chris Omalo, mm-hmm. you handled this. Martha Wangari was at the Senate back then. Mm-hmm. If it comes to the house, do you think that it is possible that members of parliament, members of the National Assembly, could agree with this?
Now, first and foremost, I want to say that it's the responsibility of any government of the day to ensure there's economic stability in the country. I want to recognize or salute the former president, Mwai Kibaki. Mm-hmm. When he came to power, the GDP of this country was growing at a negative rate. And he came up with something, ERS, the Economic Recovery Strategy, which was aimed at wealth creation and employment. And from that time, the GDP growth came positive, up to almost 7%. Mm-hmm. When the Jubilee government took over power, you can see where we are in terms of excessive borrowing. That is where we have a big problem. Right now, the government has said it's broke. They've reduced 17 billion of the money that is supposed to go to the counties, saying we don't have money. Mm-hmm. As we speak, in terms of CDF, the money has not been raised. We have so many Kenyans out there, they cannot access bursary. The government is broke. We are asking the questions. Kenyans pay taxes. Where does the money go to? Mm-hmm. The issue of interest rate capping. In many other jurisdictions, when you go to in Europe, in Asia, there's that liberalized economy. And in many countries, you find the banking aspect is controlled by the forces, the market forces, mm-hmm. the demand and the supply. And there's that element of professionalism. In this country, banks have been taking advantage of the consumers. They were making super profits. So to me, when this bill came to Parliament, being sponsored by the MP of Kiambu, General Judy Jomo, I was there to second this, because we left this to the banks to be able to regulate themselves, mm-hmm. and to be able to make normal profits, not abnormal profits. Because you find that many Kenyans who are borrowing money, and in the long run, the collateral used, whether it's a house, is being auctioned. So there was that element of non-professionalism. And that's why this bill came from the house. And it was overwhelming. Mm-hmm. If you borrow money today, sometimes back, the banks will increase, put extra costs without even informing the person who borrowed. So we saw there was that element of that greed. And this law came into cap. And there was that base rate, and they were allowed to be given an extra 4%. Mm-hmm. In other countries, from the base rate, they only add about 1% or 2%. This time, it was capped, and there was that 4% to be added. Still, when they control their overheads, they can make profits. So these banks went ahead, instead of making the money be accessible to the consumers, so that they can have, people can borrow, can have loans to establish their businesses, they went on a go slow. Mm-hmm. They did not want to give money to the Kenyans. Mm-hmm. And you know, the president cannot come in because the president is an interested party. He does business in terms of banking. We know the banks that the president family owns. Which so it would be, you don't know.
No, I don't.
No. You should be able to know these things. You he has had interest in commercial bank in Africa. We've seen all this. And it's in the public, of course, in the public domain. So the president should not come.
Is in the public domain.
Absolutely.
No, don't drag the president.
It is. So there's no way you can expect the president to come in and say, please stop this.
If at all,
you realize even when it came to ascending,
who signed this bill?
Eh? My question
is, took so long.
But did he sign or not?
Away from the president.
Did he sign or not?
If at all you get to a point where it has to be repealed, Are members of parliament going to be called upon to go through that?
I was coming to answer. Yes. I was just giving you a background. So I want to come and respond to this. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Maybe it was under duress. You never know.
What do you mean? Because the president cannot be under duress. If he did not want to sign it, he would
have. When this matter comes to the floor of the House, of course, the person moving this has the burden to prove to the Kenyans. We must be able to evaluate and see, after the repealing, what is the cost-benefit analysis? Has it been of merits or demerits? So once that evaluation is done, the members of parliament will be able to debate. Mm-hmm. Parliament is a house of debate. Is a house where people speak on facts. So Kenyans will be able to debate. Mm-hmm. So let it come back to parliament, if that's the case. But IMF cannot come and dictate to members of parliament that should be able to do this.
But IMF appears to have a stronghold on Kenya in terms
it
of...
It cannot do that.
There's money that we need as a country right now from that direction.
Yeah.
We have to give in to some extent as well to some
of the demands. We are not getting money from IMF. We are going to Eurobonds.
I think, and Honorable Chris knows this very well. Suspended. Even him personally, mm-hmm. I can assure you he has a loan service. He's mm-hmm. servicing a loan somewhere. Yes. If not one, maybe several.
Absolutely.
Yeah? And you see, it's not... And even as an organization, borrowing is not a crime, mm-hmm. by the way. And I don't think we are the highest in the world for borrowing. And that has been demystified. But what is important is, what do you do with the money that you borrow? For me, even the Eurobond, what do we do with our money?
Yes.
And that is what we must focus on. And the issue of the rate caps, it's how many years since it was signed? It's a few years, I think 2 years or so. What we need to see is a progress report. Have Kenyans mm-hmm. enjoyed what was being intended? Mm-hmm. Have Kenyans enjoyed cheap credit? Are they being still auctioned every day? Are they still having problems mm-hmm. paying their loans? Let us review that. We must mm-hmm. not do it under what he calls duress from IMF. Mm-hmm. We must now look at it as Kenyans and debate it, as he says, in Parliament. But in terms of, you know, when you drag the president, people like doing this. Because even them, they're in business. You know, it's not a crime to do business, mm-hmm. even for the president. And unless, if he had a vested interest, he had the chance not to sign this bill when he did. But he did. So in terms of having that drive to serve Kenyans, I think the president has already demonstrated that. And more importantly, in this conference we had in Mombasa, we had, what is his name?
The speaker.
No, the former MP of...
Rongo.
Yes.
Dalmas Otieno.
Dalmas Otieno. Mm. Dalmas Otieno made a very interesting presentation. When he was a minister, I think, or assistant minister, the manufacturing to GDP was 13%. I think the highest it has ever been. And in this term for Jubilee, the president has already said one of the things he wants to actually invest on is the issue of raising that to 20% mm-hmm. and to have more manufacturers be able to set up base in Kenya. Why? What will that do? We don't only raise it to 20% just for the figure.
Mm-hmm.
What will that do in terms of looking into unemployment of the young people, looking at how many opportunities do you create? So in terms of the rate caps, let them bring it to, let anyone, even the majority leader, bring it to parliament. Let us debate it. We must look and really protect the interests of Kenyans. Okay. Because we may look at the few who are doing business up here and forget the majority,
the majority
who are being auctioned from Shylocks, from I don't know what. They're having problems servicing their loans. But let me say something in the Muli before I close. Last year, and in fact the last 2 years, have been a very difficult time politically and for this country. We have had an electioneering period for over 2 years. We have done nothing else. We are just campaigning for a whole year. And let me tell you, even to thrive economically, how we have not sunk as a country is still, you know, is still a wonder. If it was done to any other country, they would collapse. So when I hear Rotich admit, we have a shortage, we have a deficit, that's fine, of whatever billion it is. But it doesn't mean the government is broke. We only had, we wanted to collect this amount of money in revenue. We did not meet that. And why did we not meet it? Because the environment was also not easy. When these guys are out there in the streets every now and then, and you expect the same government to have fruits for you, it's not easy.
Because
and
we must not be,
and you know, in my language, in the Muli, we must not be like the hyena, just that is just waiting for the hand to fall to get food.
Okay.
It can't work like that.
Okay. On this issue of interest rate caps.
On the interest rate caps, Freddie, for us to move forward as a country, we must make a very distinct difference between populism and reality.
Mm-hmm.
We were here seated on the Power Breakfast show when this thing came up for debate 2 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And we were with my friend, Honorable Kimani Ichung'wah. And I opposed the rate cap.
Yeah.
I say this is not good for us economically
mm-hmm.
because what will happen is the banks will stop lending to the normal people.
Mm-hmm.
They'll prefer to put their money in treasury bills, which is almost at 11-12%, it is much safer and eliminates that risk, then give it to a risky person at 14%. Mm-hmm. And the person who will suffer is the normal mwananchi. The people who are going to benefit are the very big corporations, mm-hmm. who the banks see are less risky and can lend at 14%. The breweries, the Safaricoms, and all that. And Kimani Ishugwa told me, yawe wacha kizungu mingi. People need cheap loans. Mm-hmm. And I told them it's wrong. Fast forward to that, when the president was signing that bill into law, and I challenge you, media, to go and get that picture, everybody was happy, but one person who was very sad in that picture. It was the governor of the central bank. Because he knew, as an economist, and a renowned economist, that this was wrong, it was going to help hurt the economy.
That you want exactly to tell me that parliamentarians don't have economists?
Let me give him a chance. Let me just, whatever, and it's going to come to Parliament, and you'll be able to debate based on all the facts. Mm. But I'll also now tell you, I'm also speaking now as a private citizen, as a businessman, as somebody who interacts also with the local one.
You're a businessman as well.
What is happening now is anybody or 95% of the people who go, ordinary people, who go to the banks to get loans are being denied. Because the banks are saying, why should I lend you money while I can put the money somewhere else and get a return with little risk? So these people, the same people that Parliament was trying to protect, have gone to loan sharks. If you look at people like Platinum Credit and see how much investment those guys are making, they've gone to the mutuaries whose interest rates are, forget 14 or 20%. Chris, the interest rate of mutuaries is 120% a year, 10% every month. Yeah, and that's where people are flocking to because they're not getting loans.
So it was not necessarily...
Economically, it was completely wrong. And that's why the IMF have come in. Yes. Now, what I urge the National Assembly to do is when they begin to debate this, can they have the economists, the regulators, the governor of Central Bank, and other development partners like the IMF to come and really show the effect of this rate cap. Okay. And I'll tell you, Mheshimiwa Malwa has said the economy grew at 7% during the former president's time. Yeah? People are still doing loans at 24%.
Guys, we do have about 2 minutes to wrap up, and I really wanted us to use that for our final remarks. Yeah. On this issue, I'm sorry to cut you short on that, but you could use 1 minute for that as well.
Yeah.
Because I need us to find out going forward what will happen, because politically the stories are disappearing. What's happening politically, you could choose to comment on that as well. You could decide to continue with this, but as you give your final comments, about 45 seconds each, let's start with you, Bwana Omalo.
I think I want to tell the former deputy governor, it is basic economics. You go read about the demand and supply. You don't need to be an economist. When the price of a commodity goes down, the demand will go higher, and accessibility will be better. So in this case, by capping the interest rate, the price will go down, many people will be able to afford it. But the banks did contrary. And this is something, if the report comes out, is actually unethical. So what is supposed to have happened when the interest rates goes down, many people should be able to access these loans and be able, like the youth, be able to start up business that can be able to pay back. When you look at the Jubilee agenda of housing, one of the strategies for you to succeed in housing, ensure the conducive environment, the interest rates are low, so that the mid-level Kenyans can be able to access loans in terms of mortgage. Mm-hmm. That's one of the strategies they have to do that. So the issue of us going through the duress of IMF, I think it's totally wrong.
Okay.
When the matter comes to Parliament, we're going to debate it objectively, and we'll require this report from the governor of Central Bank, who is the regulator of the banking industry, to be able to tell us, if the interest went down, why is it that accessibility was not enhanced?
Okay.
If there's anything of professionalism that was not done, then those particular banks must be punished.
Okay.
Lastly, what I want to say is that this country, I think we have a problem. The issues of overborrowing. And we are seeing issues here. You borrow what you can be able to sustain. The same IMF, they cautioned the Jubilee government of overborrowing.
Mm-hmm.
In many jurisdictions, borrowing is based on the GDP. The GDP of the country and the percentage of borrowing.
Okay.
This time we've already gone beyond our ceiling. So we are calling upon those people in charge that please don't auction this country.
Okay.
You must be able to borrow what you can be able to pay.
Yes. Thank you so much, Chris Omalo. Martha Wangari.
I think listening to my colleague Honorable Amalo, it's very good that they're already contributing and taking this agenda, the four agenda that we are talking about, and giving solutions. I think we are in the right path. Mm-hmm. And though it has been a tough time politically, and with all the electioneering we've done, I think we are in a recovery mode. And if they could give the government time to work and make sure that, ensure that there are no fracas, we are sure to recover. And I think that has already been done, and the economists can tell us better. But more importantly, yesterday we celebrated the International Women's Day. And even though we have a lot to celebrate as women in terms of growth, we still have a long way to close the gender gap. If you look not only in politics, even in the academia, in the professional world, we still have a long way to go. And I normally say, we say this parliament has more women, Mweke, and out of 290 constituencies, only 23 of us are women. That is a mere 7%. 92% are held by men. So we really must not say we have reached there. We have a long way to go. Even the cabinet itself, we still have a shortfall of one cabinet secretary who should have been a woman. And when we are resuming parliament next week, mm-hmm. I hope that we can get to support the not more than two-third gender rule bill that
within
will be retabled in parliament, within the house, to actually get even parliament to be compliant to the constitutional requirement, because it's not a favor. I think we must get to a point where we are 50-50. And more importantly, I went to bury a young man yesterday called Evans Njoroge in Longonot, the Meru University SG, who was shot dead at a close range. I hope Boynette is seeing this. Let him arrest that police officer, because he is a known officer. That was clear execution, and we want to know exactly what happened to the young man and why he had to be killed. And to wish everyone a good day, even as I head to Gilgil, I'm going to Oljorai Secondary School in my constituency for an AGM on matters of education, and I wish everyone a good day.
Okay, finally, Jonathan Mwepe.
Yeah, Chris, for a country anywhere in the world to succeed, there's five things that are very important. One is healthcare. Two is education. Three is housing. Four is infrastructure. Mm-hmm. And five is jobs. Now, if your economy is on the knees, all those five things that would make a country go forward will collapse. Mm-hmm. This interest rate cap, it was in bad light economically because we're a liberalized country. Mm-hmm. How it's supposed to work is you're supposed to be lent money, and the interest rate should be based on, one, your ability to pay, two, your risk profile. Have you taken loans before and you've not been able to pay? The better you are with your credit worthiness, the lower the interest rate. We took all of that out and tried to regulate the economy, the very core economy of this country, with a law. It can't work. Okay. So what has happened is the economy has slowed down. There's no money within the economy. The government has borrowed heavily. Because of that borrowing, the government now is spending most of its money paying interest rates instead of investing in mega projects that will give people jobs. And for people to do those jobs, they need the loans. So the government has choked, mm-hmm. either with legislation or policy, all these valves that can create economic health for this country. So it's pretty much a science. It's a cause and effect. If you do things the wrong way, you're not going to get a right result. So unless we are now very honest with ourselves, take populism out of the way, don't want to say, oh, I want my constituents to like me, or I'm supporting I don't know which people. No. Mm-hmm. Just let's go back to the foundation benefits. We have professionals, economists in this country who can help with that. We have development partners who can give advice. They're not lording over us. They're giving advice, okay. to make sure that we begin to fix the mistakes we have done economically, so that our people can get jobs and our country can be successful.
Wow. Thank you so much, Jonathan Mweke, former Deputy Governor Nairobi, Chris Omalo, MP Kiminini, and Martha Wangari, MP for Gilgil constituency. What Chris Omalo says, he'll be running for governor of Trans-Nzoia in 2022.
We've not even done 1 year.
2022. Well, that has been our news review this Friday. Thank you so much for watching. Remember, Power Breakfast still continues up until 9. It is Fashion Friday, so there is that segment coming up with Joey _ Muthengi. Also, DJ Roy T-Boy will be in the house to actually pump up your Friday. Do stand by for that. My name is Freddie Ndimuli. Good morning.